Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skew the Script. Today's lesson is all about describing and visualizing quantitative data in the context of Moneyball. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on describing quantitative data. This is lesson 1.3 in our course sequence. And today we're going to talk about the movie Moneyball. It's a movie made about the Oakland Athletics baseball team about their 2002 season. The movie came out in 2011 and it was a hit. It grossed $110 million at the box office. Now, for those of you in Gen Z who don't know what movie theater is, this is the amount of money they made when they showed the movie in these theaters people go to watch movies before streaming and all that. Anyway, it's weird that the movie was so popular and that they even made a movie about the Oakland A's baseball team at all, because in the season the movie is about, that 2002 baseball season, the New York Yankees, not the Oakland Athletics, scored the most runs. The Atlanta Braves, not the Oakland Athletics, had the largest division lead at the end of the season. And the Anaheim Angels, not the Oakland Athletics, won the championship, won the World Series of the league. So today's key analysis is, why would anyone make or even watch a movie about the Oakland Athletics? If you'd like to follow along using a handout, you can print it out at this URL on our website. We're going to start today by looking at dot plots, but first, let's watch my favorite scene from the movie.
No, what's the problem, Barry?
We need 38 home runs, 120 RBIs, and 47 doubles to replace.
The problem we're trying to solve is that there are rich teams and there are poor teams. Then there's 50 feet of crap. And then there's us.
So this is what Billy Beane, the general manager of the Oakland A's, played by Brad Pitt in that scene, was talking about. These are the 2002 season team payrolls, i.e. the total amount paid by teams to their players. You can see here at the top of the list is the New York Yankees, a very wealthy baseball franchise that was able to pay their players $126 million. And because they had the highest payroll, they were probably able to recruit some of the best players, most high-value players in the league. And again, down here, you have more poor franchises, such as the Oakland Athletics, who only had the budget to pay their players a total of $40 million. And because of that budgetary constraint, may not have been able to recruit or retain high value players on their team who would go to other teams that may pay more. So in this way, baseball has a deep inequality embedded in it. And this was the challenge the Oakland A's were wanting to overcome. And here are those team payrolls visualized on a dot plot. And we can see here that I've made sure to do title, tick, tick, label, label, label for this dot plot. Make sure I get full credit on the AP exam. So I got a title here. I've shown tick marks to show the scale, and I've labeled my x-axis payroll in millions of dollars, so everyone knows what this graph is talking about. You can see over here, we have a dot representing the New York Yankees who paid their players $126 million. And then here we have two dots stacked on top of each other. These were two teams who paid their players $40 million, the Oakland A's and the Minnesota Twins. So what's nice about a dot plot is you get to see every data point on a full scale. But some disadvantages, though, is that you can't see every point's exact value. You have to estimate it based on the scale, and it can be overwhelming for large data sets that have so many dots lying around. So how can we visualize the same data so that we see every data point's exact value? Well, to do that, we can use a stem plot. So first, to make a stem plot, we want to group our data. We notice that there are two teams with payrolls in the $30 million range. There are seven teams with payrolls in the $40 million, and there are five teams with payrolls in the $50 million. And so we can group this data based on the tens of millions of dollars. We have stems going from $30 million all the way to $120 million. And in addition to stem, we're going to make some leaves. You can see the plant metaphor here. These are the individual observations. So for example, the Tampa Bay Devil Rays paid their players $34 million. And so we're going to put them in the $30 million stem, and they're going to be represented by the four. Their leaf is $4 million. They paid their players $34 million. So the Rays get that place in our graph. The Montreal Expos, who paid their players $39 million, get the nine on the 30 stem. The A's paid their players $40 million, and so did the Twins. So they go here in the 40 stem, and we can fill this out for the rest of the data. As always, to get full credit, title, tick, tick, label, 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 I put my title here, but what's really important for a stem plot is having a key. In this case, I'm going to show one data point, 7.5 represents a team payroll of $75 million, where 7 is the stem, 5 is the leaf. Now, an advantage of the stem plot is that you get to see exact data values. You don't have to estimate them based on visually looking at a scale. The disadvantage is that it's overwhelming, again, for large data sets, and it'd be a lot to plot if you had thousands of data points. So what is a good data visual if we have a large data set? Well, that's a histogram. So we can take large data sets and summarize them a bit more compactly through a frequency table, where we have intervals of data values and the amount of data values that fall into those intervals, i.e. the frequency. So we see here in the interval between $20 or $39 million, two teams paid within those intervals. 12 teams paid within the interval of $40 to $59 million. And we can fill out the rest of the table. And we see here there are a total of 30 teams. So my frequency will add up to 30. And note that one team, the Yankees, were the only team with a payroll in the $120 to $139 million interval. So we have here our frequency table, and now we're going to make a histogram based on this. We're going to make the y-axis of our histogram the frequency and the x-axis the team payroll. And this is what a histogram looks like. It looks kind of like a bar plot, but there are no gaps between sequential bins. And we can see here that if we want to interpret this, say we're looking at the 80 to 99 million bin, that bar right there, and we see that has a height of 4, that means that 4 teams have a payroll between $80 to $99 million. And as always, title, tick, tick, label, label, label. I have a title, I've labeled my axes, and I have tick marks on both axes showing the scale. Now, in addition to a frequency table, there's also something called a relative frequency table, which is a very similar concept, except about percentages. So for example, 2 out of the 30 MLB teams paid their players between $20 and $39 million. 2 out of 30 is 0.067, which means that 6.7% of teams paid their players between $20 and $39 million. 2 out of 30, 6.7%. 12 out of those 30 teams, or 40% if you divide, paid their players between $40 to $59 million, and we can do this for the rest. And we can make a relative frequency histogram from those relative frequencies. It's the exact same thing basically as a frequency histogram, but the y-axis is now percent instead of those counts with frequencies. But you can see here, it looks largely the same. So the advantages of histograms are that they're good for summarizing large data sets. The disadvantages are that you can't see individual data values, and if you want that extra granularity and specificity with a small data set, you're not going to get that from a histogram. So when we're describing a data plot, we want to use what's called CSOCS. So if you're asked to describe a distribution that's quantitative, you want to talk about context, shape, outliers, center, spread, or CSOCS in our acronym. So when talking about shape, there's a couple things we want to talk about. One is modes. Modes is kind of like the number of humps. It's the most frequent values in your histograms, dot plots, et cetera. So in this case, we can see one, or it's unimodal, we have one hump, and bimodal, two humps. Those are the main ones you might see. We also want to talk about with shape, skew. There's right skew, symmetric, and left skew. Here's how to tell the difference. With a right skew distribution, you'll see a tail on the right where there's some unusual data values that are fairly high, or less frequent data values that are very high. Left skew, there's a tail on the left where there's some less frequent data values that are very low compared to the rest of the data. And then for symmetric, you have pretty even on both sides. You'll note that skew the script's logo is a left skew distribution. And there's a reason for this. So as I tell my students all the time, if you work really hard, study very hard, and try and learn not just the formulas behind the math, but the concepts in real world context, you're going to see your scores as a class go from a right skew, where you have a big hump with many low scores and very few high scores, the tails on the right, to a left skew, where you have few low scores and many high scores on your exams. And so that's the story behind our logo. So say you were asked to describe this distribution of team payrolls. So said, describe the distribution. We want to talk about context. This is about team payrolls. Shape, we see this is unimodal, one hump, and it has a right skew. Outlier, I don't see any gaps between my intervals here. So there's no apparent obvious outliers, very unusual data points. center, we're going to see a more specific method for finding the central data value in a later lesson. But for now, we're just going to eyeball it. It seems like the central data values are located in that $60 to $79 million range. And then the spread, our data values vary from between 20 to 39 million and 120 to 139 million. Because we can't see the specific data points in a histogram, we don't know the exact range, but we can say it's between those intervals. So putting it all together, if you're asked to describe the distribution, you can say this as a response. Data was collected on baseball team payrolls. The distribution is right skew and unimodal. So I've got in context, I've got in shape. There are no obvious outliers, and the distribution is centered between 60 to 79 million. We've got outliers and we got center. The payrolls vary from between 20 to 39 million to between 120 to 139 million. That is our spread. So we've done the full CSOCS. Now you might be thinking, how the heck do I get the shape of a stem plot? If I'm asked to describe a stem plot, what would I do? It's vertical, it's kind of weird. Well, all you gotta do is rotate 90 degrees counterclockwise and boom, you have it on a horizontal axis. And you can see here, this is right skew as we saw in the histogram with the team payrolls. But now let's get back to our original question. Why would anyone make or watch a movie about the Oakland Athletics? Well, as we saw with this payroll data, the Oakland Athletics were not a very well-paid team. They didn't have a high budget to pay their players compared to teams like the New York Yankees. So I'm going to show you a second scene, my second favorite scene from the movie, and then we'll discuss it.
Okay.
It's about getting things down to one number. Using the stats the way we read them, we'll find value in players that nobody else can see. People are overlooked for a variety of biased reasons and perceived flaws. Age, appearance, personality. Bill James and mathematics cut straight through that. Billy, of the 20,000 notable players for us to consider, I believe that there is a championship team of 25 people that we could afford because everyone else in baseball undervalues them. Like an island of misfit toys. Billy, this is Chad Bradford. He's a relief pitcher. He is one of the most undervalued players in baseball. His defect is that he throws funny. Nobody in the big leagues cares about him because he looks funny. This guy could be not just the best pitcher in our bullpen, but one of the most effective relief pitchers in all of baseball. This guy should cost $3 million a year. We can get him for $237,000.
So what the A's did is they used statistics to identify undervalued players, players they could afford, but that had good stats and contribute to their team. And they drafted and traded for those players. The result was this: even though the A's had a low payroll, if we visualize the number of wins among all the MLB teams, they play 162 games, so you can see how many they win. We see that the Yankees won 103 games, as you might expect, given their high payroll. They were the highest winning team. But the A's tied them at the end of the season. They also won 103 games. And this was an almost unprecedented result where a poor paying team like the Athletics, who didn't have as much of a budget as the Yankees, could have the tie for the winningest record in baseball. And this is why they made a movie about the Athletics, because of that almost miraculous result. And you can do some fun stats about this. So for example, the Yankees had $125 million payroll with 103 wins. If you divide those, that means they paid more than $1 million per win. Whereas the A's paid less than $400,000 per win. So you can see how efficient the A's were compared to the Yankees. So let's go on to our discussion question for today. Baseball is something in place called a luxury tax. Rich teams pay a tax to the league and the revenue goes to help fund poor teams. This has helped to balance out the team funding. But poor teams still say the tax isn't big enough to make much of a difference. And there's still this deep inequality between teams in baseball. So here's our discussion question. Imagine the league enacted a harsher tax in the 2002 season. Any money spent above $100 million on payroll is taxed at a 90% rate. So if your team spends any money above $100 million, 90% of that money above $100 million will be taken away and poor teams will receive those tax funds. A, how would the distribution of team payrolls change? if this tax was in place? Comment on shape, center, and spread. And B, in your opinion, how would this new, or would this new system be better for the sport? Why or why not? That's it for today's video, statisticians. We'll see you next time.